Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Wake Up Missoula. I'm your host, Scott Ramp. I'm here to tell you the news, the weather, the events, the snow on the mountains, and all sorts of wonderful things happening here in the city of Missoula. Let's kick things off with a little bit of weather. It is currently 37 degrees outside. Your high is going to be 39. Your low is going to be 20. High is going to be 38 by Saturday. Things are going to get a little bit colder by Sunday, like the last couple weeks, but you can expect your highs to come back by Monday into the 38s, but you can see some snow potentially happening throughout the weekend just as well. This next part is from onthesnow.com, and you get a nice representation of how much snow has fallen on your favorite mountains in Montana. In Whitefish, you got a fresh inch of snow in the last 24 hours, but it looks like it had 9 inches in the last 72 hours. Blacktail Mountain Skier, it had 1 inch, but it does have 11 inches in the last 72 hours. Montana Snow Bowl had 3 inches in the last 72 hours, but it looks like Lost Trail, Big Sky, Bridger Bowl, Discovery, most of those places that haven't had any fresh new powder. Showdown Montana had 2 inches in the last 72 hours, but they say that they're all good to go. You can see on the clouds on the right-hand side, it is like going to be cloudy, some snow, some sunshine happening through some of these places as well. But yeah, we're going all the way down, and Red Lodge is not going to have any fresh snow. But of course, I don't suspect any of you guys going all the way to eastern Montana to go to Red Lodge. So let's move on. In news, if you haven't already heard, more and more people are showing up in Helena to oppose cuts to healthcare programs in Montana. The changes are part of rules and a new manual proposed by the State Department of Public Health and Human Services. If the changes go into effect, things like therapy sessions for people on Medicaid with a mental illness or substance abuse disorders will be capped at 12 a year. Stays in group homes and would also be limited and targeted case management for some adults and youth would be limited to 24 hours per year. So if you had a case manager and you're suffering from mental illness, you would meet with your case manager 24 hours over the course of a year. So Governor Steve Bolt called for a special session last November to lower than expected budget that forced these cuts to happen in the first place. Of course, to save money, the department is also implementing something called a utilization review. That review means that the health department will contract with a company that will determine if some services are medically necessary. Of course, you can find out more about this by going to helenair.com. It's the Helena Independent Record, and you can find out more about that. So in an NPR poll in national news, they asked both Republicans and Democrats what they think they should have more strict gun laws or less strict gun laws. And since the Florida shooting, both sides have had an increase in percentage for more strict gun laws. So so as you can see here, overall, it seemed like it jumped from 68% to 75%. So that's three quarters of a majority for stricter gun regulations and laws for people. Democrats had 84 to 92% jump. Republicans had a 55 to 59% jump. Independents had a 61 to 68% jump. The poll also found a widespread bipartisan support for a range on gun controls policies, which include requiring background checks for all gun buyers, which was 98.4%, adding people with a mental illness to the federal gun background check systems, that was 92%, raising the legal age to purchase guns from 18 to 21, that was 82%, banning bump stocks, 81%, banning high-capacity ammunition magazines that hold more than 10 rounds, that was 73%, and banning assault-style weapons was 72%, much higher than it has been in the last couple of years. But of course, it was clear partisan gulf. 68% of Republicans favor the idea of training teachers to carry compared to just 18% of Democrats. That was one of the things that they kind of like separated on. Arming teachers was by far the most polarizing policy suggestion. The poll found that 50-point divide between Republicans and Democrats. 75% of the people polled said that gun laws should be stricter than they are today. That is an increase in a short period of time from October 2017 when NPR conducted a similar survey in the wake of the Las Vegas shooting. Then 68% said gun laws should be stricter than they were. So that concludes all your news items. I got a bunch of new programs. And then when we come back, we're going to be talking about some of the movies that are coming out this weekend. So stay with me.
Because our alumni achievements are exceptional. Like I'm looking at Johanna back there, who's an entrepreneur. She started dancing in college. So she was one of my students. And her accomplishments are extraordinary. She founded a company called Dancedor, and she's incredibly successful. and started dancing with us. And so, like, I think there are students who start in college and there are students who continue in college, and there's a place, there's a meeting ground there that's way more democratic than I think might exist in dance academies or in studios that lead up into university setting. There are some, I think there are some colleges that are conservatory based, but the other ones that aren't, that are more public state universities, there's a different kind of philosophy that grounds those dance programs and a different kind of accessibility for students who are coming in.
Okay, well, I'm Dusty Deshaw, and I'm not here to talk about some character. I'm here to talk about my family. So it makes it a little easier because I don't have to make anything up. My family has been involved in Missoula activities pretty much from the earliest of times in Montana, but I'm going to go back a lot further than that. We think that our family originated in western France. The name Deshaw means of the fields in French, and it's a very common name in France. I found it all over the country. But we, family lore has it, we came from the Normandy region, and I've done some DNA testing, which tends to suggest that that might be true.
And, you know, doing so by fiat or by regulation, you know, it induces trade-offs, right? You know, it's not like we just say, oh yeah, we're just going to say we want more money and there's no consequences, right? Is, you know, there's trade-offs that come when you try and do that, and, you know, the question is well, what are those trade-offs, and are we okay with them?
People died asking for minimum wage. They got killed for actually asking people to pay them minimum wage. So there are trade-offs, for sure.
Yeah, no, but you know, even economically, right? You know, I mean, what we're seeing in Seattle is mixed, right? You know, we don't have perfect data, but you know, Seattle is leading the forefront. And the, you know, the best study that's come out about it suggests that raising the minimum wage hasn't been good for minimum wage workers in Seattle.
Scene. And Dilla Von Drie goes out, and he's sort of noteworthy because he was one of the first Europeans to go down to the Mandan villages at the Great Bend of the Missouri, and he came back up, and when he was out and about, he collected maps from people. So here is his sort of journal entry where he mentions the Mandan. The nations about 300 leagues further down are sedentary, raise crops, and for lack of wood, make themselves mud huts.
Hey guys, welcome back. Now it's time for a little pre-critic. Kicking things off is that one favorite actress that everyone still is all about, and that is Jennifer Lawrence. So, from Hollywood, who feels like messing with Jennifer Lawrence in all the wrong ways, comes Red Sparrow. It's kind of like Basic Instinct meets spy thriller with none of the thriller, but all of Jennifer Lawrence torture for mother. Watch her attempt a Russian accent while you get thrown into a world of cloak and dagger women trafficking that threatens women to join or die the secret slut Russian government. That's basically the movie. Charles Bronson and Jeff Goldblum ain't in this movie, and we dive into it once again to a reboot franchise from a hyper-violent and crime-ridden city in Death Wish. A man's family is attacked, and it's up to Bruce Willis to get revenge by being Bruce Willis. In an action franchise, watch Elizabeth Shue die within the first part of this movie because she plays the wife, and their daughter into a coma until Bruce Willis decides to shoot the bad guys in the face. Be aware that this is an Eli Roth film, and he's made such gems as Green Inferno and Hostel, and Hostel Part 2. It's basically torture, horror, sink in probably something. Or other. All right. And this other movie, there's another foreign movie that you're probably not going to even see here in the city of Missoula, but this is a movie that uses military lettering. The movie's called Foxtrot. Here's a synopsis. A troubled family face the facts when something goes terribly wrong at their son's desolate military post. That's basically it. So basically, it's a foreign film. Not sure what it's about, but you know, if anything... But you don't know anyone in it and have no reason to bring this up in regular conversation because the chance of you are meeting that special someone who shares the love of a foreign military type movies that are dramas are pretty slim. Okay, so let's move on. It is Flagship Friday, and I brought back some the Flagship Friday video of the week from Lowell Elementary. So when I come back, we're going to talk about some city council stuff, so stay with me.
You can't be playing Minecraft on the school's computer.
I'm going to tell the teacher.
Good luck with that.
Well, I guess that's my job for the day.
Yes.
There's this girl over there, and she's playing on the school's computer.
Well, it's after school.
But she's not allowed to be playing on the school's computer.
It's after school!
Wow, this is a lot of work, but fun.
You're playing Minecraft?
Well, Roblox is better.
You're playing Minecraft? I love that game. I wish I was in it.
Me too.
Did you hear that?
Ew!
Oh no, the lights went out.
Who could have spelled the light? I'm worried about my game.
Amazing.
Roblox graphics are better.
What now?
Uh-oh, it's getting dark.
That means creepers!
What are you doing?
I'm playing Minecraft.
Are you supposed to be using the school
No.
Wait, is that part of the game?
It is now.
Of course, last summer was one of the worst smoke seasons in the Missoula Valley in past years. So public safety and health in the city council meeting are going to be talking about this. And we kick things off with Sarah Cofield. And she talks about MCPS students with asthma and also sensitive groups, how they dealt with some of this smoke inhalation during the year.
Is inside the Missoula's MCPS school district, more than 500 children have asthma flagged on their files. That's a lot of kids that we know about in Missoula that have asthma and are sitting through these wildfire smoke events. And that's part of why I do what I do and talk a lot about smoke and keeping people protected, is because we know we have all of these kids that are affected by asthma.
All right, so that was Sarah Cofield once again. But of course, she also mentions that pregnant women's children are also affected by this smoke in their second trimester, and usually it's really bad for kids who are developing lungs, because you know kids usually don't finish developing their lungs and their bodies until they reach full adulthood, which so for some kids can be anywhere between 18 and 26. So just be aware of that, because kids are considered sensitive groups. So basically, one of the questions many people are asking is just like, okay, so this is only like basically a shot in the dark, kind of like once a year type of event that happens in the city of Missoula. And what is the long-term effects? And so basically, Sarah Cofield kind of talks about what information they already have on some of the long-term health effects that this smoke particulate matter does to the city and to people in general.
Wildfire smoke health studies have been growing, but that kind of long-term tracking of someone who's been exposed to wildfire smoke their whole life has not been completed, in part because wildfire smoke, at least in the United States, or especially in Montana, was not really an issue until about 20 years ago. There is some research that is being done on wildland firefighters, where we're seeing that the folks that are exposed to smoke over that prolonged period of time are more susceptible to those chronic diseases developing and have a higher cancer risk, I believe. I'd have to look up the paper again to give you more confidence on that. So there is some research that's being done on those. But those guys typically are exposed, those men and women, are typically exposed to a more prolonged duration throughout the year than someone during a smoke event. Although what's changing is these prolonged smoke events. Used to be wildfire season was a week here and there. This year it was 2 months. And so that is something that is going to be changing the game. But since it is an emerging realm of study, we don't know. The typical wisdom has been that once the smoke is gone, people recover. So the most severe health concerns are while the smoke is present, and then some weeks afterward you still see some lingering effects. I do know that Some of the kids this year were still going into the doctor with aggravated asthma well after when the smoke was gone.
All right. So that was just kind of like some of the effects of some of the smoke that this last year has done. 30% of people are affected by smoke and particulate matter in some forms and are considered part of the sensitive groups. And these aren't talking about children. These are people, citizens here in the city of Missoula who are affected by the smoke. And a lot of times it's a 30%, and that usually transposes to a national average of how many people are actually sensitive to this kind of smoke and particulate matter. So, but of course, Missoula went above the standard air quality for PMs more than 20 times just this last summer. Usually there's an indication of being how much is tolerable and which one is exceeding that amount of 20 amount of PMs. So we went into very hazardous territories along that time during this year as well. But of course, Sarah has a graph of air quality from last year, just so you guys, if you guys want to know exactly how bad the air quality was.
Is the significant wildfire smoke years in Missoula. You see 2000 is that blue line that you can kind of see right there. Really bad, we had some really, really bad days. This is 2003, the red with the peak. 2015 had some really rough days. This is 2017 right here. That is, we're missing right dead. It probably came up to about there. Our machine got clogged. It was a really bad day. I'm sure you guys remember it. And then there's 2012 where we go into October. And then there's that dotted line is that 24-hour average that we always want to stay below. So those are the significant wildfire smoke years in Missoula so far. But one thing that I haven't really talked about here, but I want you to understand, is where a lot of our focus and resources went during this wildfire year is Seeley Lake. Seeley Lake had the worst smoke event possibly ever in North America.
All right, so talking about Seeley Lake and talking about the Missoula Valley, the Lolo Fire and the Seeley Lake Fire, they were very close to the communities in general, so a lot of that particulate matter were much higher than what it has been. So, of course, this year was especially bad because of the close proximity to the fires in Seeley Lake and Lolo areas that affected the Missoula area, and Missoula is usually downwind of the Lolo area, so it wasn't hard for the smoke to invade the Missoula Valley. But there was also some evidence from this update that contributed to this bad flu season as well. So a lot of people are a lot of from Sarah Cofield mentioned in a presentation that some of the flu season it didn't help people this flu season because of these fires, because usually what you use the time during the winter time when the air is a little bit better, if you don't really count the diesel from all the car exhaust and all that stuff, then people use this time to usually recover and clear out their lungs from all the particulate matter that comes through their system. And then, of course, you know, you're still kind of recovering from that. So, like she said, that's just an update of public safety and health. You can watch the whole meeting by going to ci.missoula.mt.us. This is the perfect website for learning everything about the city of Missoula, and they have programs on there as well. But if you want to find out more information, you can also go to MCAT.org. Also, there's another meeting. It's for the admin and finance committee meeting, and Mayor John Engen does a brief little introduction from the Arts Missoula, formerly known as Missoula Cultural Council.
We don't have the ability to hire or create departments to fill some of these gaps, and so what the Cultural Council and Arts Missoula has done is fill those gaps by using internal capacity, resources, talent, cross-training, etc., to make a big difference in the way we operate in terms of arts and culture in the city of Missoula. The most recent example is the additional funding we've provided to allow the Public Art Committee to have some additional administrative support, which has been a big deal for that committee, and its ability to get things done on behalf of the city. We recognized another one of these holes, another one of these gaps in the community, in no small part as a function of the organizational changes at the University of Montana and some changes around the way international programming and cultural training has been done over time.
All right, so the brief introduction is Arts Missoula provides service in the community, including maintaining a community events calendar, administering the Missoula Public Art Committee, the Sister City Program, the Montana Book Festival, and Spark. Arts ignites learning, producing First Night Missoula, coordinating First Friday Gallery Night information, conducting periodic economic impact studies related to the arts and other related items. This enhancement would provide the funding for a Director of Global and Cultural Affairs, developing programs in cultural sensitivity trainings for schools, city, and county employees. So, and other public and private groups expanding sister city activities and incentives and implementing community outreach programs specific to global issues. So here's Tom Benson, Director of Arts Missoula, and he talks about what this money from the city would do for them.
County employees and other public or private groups, expanding our sister city activities and initiatives, and developing and implementing community outreach programs related to global issues specifically. Also included in this enhancement is a one-time request for funding for a staff member to attend the 25th anniversary of our sister city partnership with Neckargemünd this June. And finally, because we are transitioning just a few years ago, our office was two people, and this will make it five, we're asking for some additional funding for office management. We can go into the details. I also brought a few people along who can speak in support of this initiative.
All right, and Tom Benson brings a couple people, and we have the lady Mary Poole from the Director of Global and Mary Poole, who is the Executive Director of Soft Landing Missoula. She talks about this new position that Tom Benson is proposing. So here is Mary Poole.
And these folks, what's really awesome about the organizations here in Missoula is everybody's trying to do the best job that they can, and they're doing a bang-up job, but we also need to be able to provide them with the resources that they need to serve our clients in the best way possible, and I think that this position could really, really help with that, because it's something that it's, you know, we speak of gaps, and it's something that's a gap that's not being filled, and we speak of what kind of financial benefits. Well, employers are obviously needing these things too. So, I guess I would just say the other thing that excites me about this position is we see, we do have a small international community here, and it is growing. As it's growing, there's different types of people in these communities, and I'm not seeing, in my experience, these communities very connected. For example, there's an international community at the university, and they're not always having the avenue and the path to hook up with supporting the refugees that are coming in, or other kids in our school systems, or people that are here working. And so it would be really cool if we had some liaison that was connecting those communities so that they can support each other. There's a lot of isolation that happens here, and not just with my clients, I know in other international communities. So seeing that happen would be really exciting. So,
all right, so that was Mary Poole, the Executive Director of Softline Missoula. Softline Missoula is a refugees program here in the Missoula to help families reintegrate into a new community. So basically, the next one we got here is Bob Stein-Swartz. He's the director of the Montana World Affairs Council, and he talks about how his program has grown, and with this new position would also help grow this and many other programs in the city of Missoula. He also speaks in favor of this.
All of you. This is an economic benefit, it's a cultural benefit, it's a social benefit for us here in this community. When I think about the programs at the council, about 11 or 12 years ago, we did a program called the World Affairs Council, Council in the Classroom, and our World Quest competition. We had four teams originally that came from local high schools to participate. Our last competition, and John Ingen is very knowledgeable about this, we filled the ballroom at the University of Montana. We are outgrowing the ballroom because we've got schools coming from all over the state of Montana to compete on global issues and awareness. There's an economic benefit to the university, is there not? When these students are sitting at the U, they're spending 2 days, they're meeting with advisors, they're getting people to speak to them about opportunities excuse me, at the university, possibly some of these students then become representatives and go to the University of Montana. The business community, I have untold hours with meeting with members of the state, local, and international business communities that are looking at trying to establish businesses in the state of Montana. Direct benefits to the state, to Missoula, to Bozeman, the cities where some of the economic vitality is taking place. You have to connect the dots here, folks. It's happening. And we are standing at a unique opportunity to provide the funding to be able to continue to move these type of initiatives forward. So happy to provide, answer any questions you may have, but this comes from, literally for me, decades of experience and seeing the benefits and the changes that are taking place. And
That was Bob Schwartz. And yeah, that was my last quote of the meeting. Public hearing will be set for March 19th. It's not next Monday, but it's it's going to be 2 weeks from next Monday, and they have their public meeting. And so they will decide, the city of Missoula will decide to grant Missoula Cultural Council to increase the fiscal year 2018 budget by $34,424 and the fiscal year 2019 base budget by $79,000. So that's what happens in the city council meeting. I got another video for you guys to transition into art. So this is from the Zootown Arts Community Center, and this will be going on until March 5th. And then when I come back, we'll talk about all your art for your first Friday here in the city of Missoula. Well, this is the part of the show where I give you your art guide. It is the first Friday of the month, and first Friday, hosted by the Missoula Cultural Council, which is Arts Missoula, which facilitates the downtown art scene to invite people who haven't a little taste of art and culture of the city of Missoula. Just to go out and hang out. They usually have a bunch of deals in the downtown area in terms of pricing and all sorts of wonderful things as well that go associated with First Friday. So it's a good excuse to go out and about, especially today. Kicking it off is Index of the Heart. And this is a installation that's opening up at Bernice's Bakery. So Bernice's Bakery, and all these events are from 5 to 8 p.m. roughly. But of course, this is mostly like a kickoff event. A lot of art studios start art installations today to facilitate the First Friday event. And this is a daughter of a High Plains drifter and a punk rock skater. Local artist Maxine Beard presents Index of the Heart, snippets of the most intimate moments and feelings a person experienced, presented as a series of colors and abstract thought. Her show consists of a series of watercolor and marker originals alongside prints that can be custom ordered. Next, we got Scrapboard Art Show. This is going to be a market on Front. This is featuring the scratchboard artist Elizabeth Ghirardino. Wine and cheese will be served and enjoy some live music as well. And this is going to be the market on Front. And I think this is really cool because this is not a photo. This is not a photo. First Friday featuring maker Laurel Hill Jewelry. So The first Friday, as we celebrate Laurel and her beautiful handmade creations, Laurel's Hill Jewelry is inspired by the Anima Mundi, the universal shapes and symbols that we recognize as significant in the forms of functional of historical cultural adornment. Pieces are forged in the mountains of western Montana using traditional metalworking techniques with a focus on sustainability. And this is going to be at Noteworthy Paper and Press, and this is located at 219 South 3rd Street. Next, we got Above and Beyond, and this is going to be at the Artist Shop, and this is going to be running from March 1st through the 31st, and this is going to be at the Artist Shop, and it features art by Bev Gluckert. Next one up, we got this one is going to be at the Radius, and Radius is known for bringing a bunch of artists together in their art museum as well. They always have a lot of really cool and unique sculpture, paintings, mixed media type stuff there as well, photography, and over 100 exception-defined artworks by 28 artists. All artwork, paintings, sculptures, collage, and ensemble works, fiber art, ceramics, and more incorporate at least one physical object found in Montana. So this is going to be at the Radius Gallery, and you can check it out. Next, we got Lake Missoula Tea Company is hosting another one with Alicia Keys Paintings. So, lively visuals, soulful sounds, and tasty tea at Lake Missoula. This has happened from 5 to 8. She's a native to Montana, living most of her life in Missoula. Since 2011, the outpouring of Alicia Keys' work has developed a style of bright, bold colors mixed with three-dimensional layerings that she terms as aggressive canvas augmentations. Fancy words. Anyways, the next one is landscape, some landscape and other art as well. And this is let's see here. This is National Parks. Now, hold on 1 second. I'm just trying to find the right information on it. That's weird. I could have sworn I had it on here, but I must have been mistaken. Okay, so this is a showcase happening at Gecko Designs. And this is an art reception staff showcase. And this is going to have talented team from the Gecko Design are going to basically show off some of their own stuff. Gecko Design is right next to Pie Hole in the downtown area. You got Monoprints. And Monoprints is going to be at Four Ravens Gallery. So Bob Finney, a Montanan, an art teacher, and a lover of nature, creates monoprints that captures the mystery and intuition printmaking process. This monoprint world is a kind of playground for the intuition, where the choices usually bring surprises, sometimes disappointment, but usually growing harmony and a clear but not always definitive form and meaning. The next one is Katrina Rumland. And her art installation is called It Is, It Was, It Will Be. And it's going to be at E3 Convergence Gallery. And they are pleased to present her, a retired art and special education teacher. Katrina Rumland uses her recent years to expand her art-making methods and channel her creativity in her own personal work again. Using many Native American crafting techniques from beading to leatherwork and combining with those her contemporary approach to mixed media, she creates a unique, haunting pieces with a huge variety. And last, we got at the Clay Studio of Missoula. This is a community exhibition, so there's going to be many artists who contribute to their art. So this is one of the pieces that they have featured on the Missoula events page. The Clay Studio of Missoula is proud to showcase the diverse and exciting work by their own students, members, and studio artists. The exhibition will feature a sculptural and functional ceramic works created by over 30 artists in our community. The exhibit will reflect the strong creative forces we have here in Missoula. And this will be continuing on through March 30th. So if you missed the International Cups, you can check out the Missoula community artists and see how they've been doing with the Clay Studio of Missoula. They do a bunch of classes there as well. You guys should sign up. Okay, so that's basically it. That's all you need to know about what's happening for First Friday. There's a bunch of other things happening as well. But of course, this weekend, we're doing our Saturday drop-ins for kids age 9 to 13. So without further ado, here is a nice little commercial of that. And when I come back, I'll talk about all your other events that are happening this weekend as well. Hey guys, welcome back. Now it's time to talk about all the things that are happening starting this morning, your Friday morning. If your kids are interested in doing some gymnastic stuff, why not get them active and inside with Missoula Indoor Sports Arena, Roots Acro Sports Center, and the Mismo Gymnastics. All three different places basically doing the same thing, and you get your choices. And it happens basically from now all the way until about noonish today as well. Other events include Missoula Public Library hosts a Tiny Tales every morning at 10:30 at various locations because they do it associated with Missoula Food Bank and Empower Place. But today it's going to story time, and Tiny Tales will be at the Missoula Public Library starting at 10:30 a.m. I just need to get it out because otherwise I'm going to feel uncomfortable the whole entire show. But anyways, yeah, and if you want to stick around a little bit longer, starting at noon today, Yarns and Watercolor is going to be at the Missoula Public Library just as well, and so you get to learn to stitch, or you get to learn to use some watercolors as well, so you can get your first Friday fix and creativity out. But also, Missoula Senior Center is doing a bridge and cribbage groups, so if you're interested in playing any of those games, bridge or cribbage, you go to the Missoula Senior Center around noonish, and you should be facilitated just perfectly. Also happening this afternoon is, I think this is a very important event. They've been doing this for a little while now, and this is hosted at Missoula Community Medical Center, and this is suicide prevention training. Montana currently has one of the highest suicide rates in the U.S., and more people in Missoula die from suicide than all forms of cancer combined. Lives can be saved if more people in our community are trained to recognize the warning signs and how to get help. This training is available for anyone who is provided free of charge. Nurses will be awarded 1.5 contact hours, whatever that means. And of course, this is a 90-minute training. You will learn to recognize the warning signs of suicide, know how to offer hope, know how to get help and save lives. And of course, advanced sign up is not required, and teens are welcome. And speaking of teens, 3:30 is the teen writers group. So if you are a writer and you're struggling to get your creativity out, this is a good way to focus it and get a good reaction, try to see this and that. And it's at the Missoula Public Library pretty much every Friday after school at 3:30, improve your writing skills or get some feedback on your stories. Family fun time at the Y. The YMCA of Missoula hosts a family fun time from 3:30 to 5:30 for anybody who is interested in doing that. And then, of course, wrapping up your Friday is all your first Friday fun stuff. So if you're interested in going out, maybe getting a bunch of cheeses and wines at many various locations in the downtown area, you may need to get a cab because there's so many. They're going to do it first Friday. And, of course, MCAT is also doing first Friday today. MCAT will be at MCT. We're not doing it here. We're going to be at MCT. MCT is doing a kind of like a kids summer camp kind of fair thing. So if you want to prepare for summer camps, go to MCT. MCAT is not going to be the only one that's going to be there. So it's a good way for us to get out into the community and basically just kind of show what MCAT has got for our summer camps. And of course, before I go into Saturday events, I might as well talk about all our camp stuff, because at MCAT.org, you can find out all information that you need to know about MCAT. All to get Spring Flux. It's happening spring break, and it happens from March 26th through the 30th, and this is a wonderful fun camp for kids who want to go from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And also, if you're a parent out there and you don't know what you're going to do for your spring break, if you're not going on a vacation and you have to work during spring break and your kids are at home and you want them to be out and doing something, this is a good way to get them out and doing things for our spring flicks. It's as simple as clicking on the link on our page. So you click here, and it'll bring you to a page where you can sign up and everything. So it's $150. That's usually associated with about $30 a day, which is 7 hours. So $30, 7 hours. So 30 divided by 7 usually equivalates to about – I'm terrible. Let's see. 4.12. I'm really trying to think about this because I have to. It's like 4.12. So it's $4.12 an hour per kid. So think about it like that. and you got yourself a pretty good babysitting service here. So that's what's happening here. But of course, let's kick things off. Let's talk about some Saturday events. I'm tired. No more plugging about our MCAT stuff until I get to our Saturday drop-ins. But of course, starting to your Saturday morning at 1 a.m. Not 1 a.m. Jeez, God. 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. Winter market is happening at the Missoula Senior Center. They host a winter market for people who apparently need a market to go to every Saturday. Community compassion and creating support workshop. The Learning Center at Ritter Wheeler is communicating compassion and creative support, a workshop for parent and mentors with Zach Morris. Not that Zach Morris, another Zach Morris. Anyways, Saturday from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m., it's a one-day workshop. Sliding scale fee is available, so if you can't pay the fee, they will have this. This workshop will include interactive activities that facilitate self-reflection, group discussion, and shared creation. If you aim to strengthen the platform from which you provide support for a young person, please join in. It's $95. It's from 9 to 5 p.m., and it's going to be at the Learning Center at Red Willow, hosted by Zach Morris, not from Saved by the Bell. The real Zach Morris. Okay, so pros, cons, the buzz on the single player health insurance. And health insurance is such a big deal, and the debate over health insurance can be more heat than light. Come to this free film, panel, discussion, and Q&A that cuts through the confusion, the pros and cons, and the buzz about single payer health insurance systems. So this happens Saturday, March 3rd, and the registration is at 9:30 a.m., and this happens at 9:45, and it's going to be at the Courtyard Marriott, which is 4559 North Reserve. Panel includes Bryce Ward, Director of UM Bureau of Business and Economic Research Healthcare Research Program. That's a long title. Carter Beck, MD, neurosurgeon, Providence St. Pat's Hospital, and Mark Mental, DO, Associate Program Director for the Osteopathic Curriculum Family Medical Residency of Western Montana. So a lot of big titles going to be there starting tomorrow at 9:45 a.m. And it's sponsored by the League of Women Voters here in Missoula and the Missoula Chapter of American Academy of Professional Coders. Wow, just a whole bunch of things. But if you want to do that, while you drop your kids off for your Saturday drop-in from 1 to 5 p.m., MCAT does Saturday drop-ins every single Saturday from 1 to 5 p.m., for $10 a pop, or a kid, you can drop your kid off and you can go and do your Saturday catch up, shopping, grocery shopping, do all that stuff. So it is a good way just to drop your kids off for a day and have them create some stop animation and short little videos as well. Try hockey for free. And when you're done with your Saturday drop-in, you can leave a little bit earlier or you leave maybe a little bit after. But try hockey for free starts at 4:30 at Glacier Ice Rink. And you get it's a one-hour clinic that allows kids 4 to 10 to learn the basic skills of hockey in a fun, safe environment. And that happens. You can register them at tryhockeyforfree.com. So it's going to be great. And also happening Saturday night is the Odyssey of the Stars. So the 18th annual Odyssey of the Stars, it is the year after J.K. Simmons did his Odyssey of the Stars, which helps basically the whole idea of Odyssey of the Stars is to sell tickets and to raise money for grants and scholarships for students that are going into some form of entertainment through the it's the UM Theater of Dance or the Theater of Fine Arts and all sorts of things. It's just whatever at the University of Montana is related to arts and entertainment. This is the Odyssey of the Stars, which helps support this as well. But the person that is being honored tomorrow night is Casey Creeley. Casey is an award-winning producer known for Top Chef, Project Runway, Project Greenlight, and Cold Justice. Her father, James Creeley, was a UM drama professor and the dean of School of Fine Arts, and she'll be there, and they'll be doing a kind of a they usually do put on a performance, a lot of mixed media, a lot of departments show off their stuff. It's going to be great, and they're going to have the theme of their Project Runway type stuff as well. So if you're interested in doing that, great. And then you will have plenty of time to go out and about that night as well. If you guys are planning on going out and about on your Saturday night, you got some DJ music at the Ballander. And, of course, you got some karaoke at VFW. Union Club is going to have a band there as well. And it is Idle Ranch Hands is going to be the Union Club, Pay Dirt at the Sunrise Saloon, and Dodgy Mountain Man is going to be the Top Hat Lounge at 4:15. So a lot of different things happening this weekend as well. And I hope you guys have that good weekend. Get out and about, do some fun things. It is basically this Saturday. For me, my story is that I'm going to be doing some Saturday drop-ins, and then me and my crew we're doing it on Saturday. We're having a party to celebrate all the crew and high school kids that helped MCAT live stream your high school sports on our Facebook page. And also you'll be able to watch a lot of those games starting on Sundays on MCAT channel 189 as well. You get to see some of the past coverage of the game, so you get to hear part of my voice along with the voices of Cole Johnson and David Yaffa. Great contributors to our sports show. They know their business. I don't. I know how to color commentate and be like, oh, look, they put the thing in the thing. That means 2 points. Great. Anyways, but that basically concludes that. This weekend's going to be a pretty fun weekend, and I hope you guys have just as much fun as I plan to do this weekend as well. So for Wake Up Missoula, I'm Scott Raff. Have a wonderful, wonderful weekend.